All right, so I believe the people are joining, so let's start. So all right, so it's Abdul Shakur. I'm regional director for Institute of Financial Accounting UK, and I warmly welcome you all in this webinar on future of money payments and the finances. So we have our today's trainer with us, Mr. Muhammad Yusuf. So let me briefly introduce that what is Institute of Financial Accounting UK. Okay, all right, so Institute of Financial Accounting UK was founded in 1916, and we are the full member of IPAC and the member of IPA group as well. And as a group, we are the largest SME focused group, and we have more than 49,000 members and students in more than 90 countries now. Okay, so as well as the recognition and collaboration is concerned, we have the global presence. As I said earlier, that we are the full member of IFAC, and we are recognized by HM Treasury UK, and we have MOUs and MRAs with different professional bodies and universities, and the members have the designatory letters, which are AFA and MIPA, and we are offering two memberships at the price of one. Okay, so as well as the global presence is concerned, we are in UK, Europe, Middle East, South Asia, and other countries as well. Okay, so as well as the 2023 and beyond is concerned, we are developing our relationship with different universities and professional bodies in Pakistan, and we are increasing our presence in Pakistan as well. And the member base is also growing in country, and we are building alliances. And recently, we have introduced our IFA education program, and we are trying to provide the value and support to the members as well. And maybe in the upcoming months or so, we will be launching our job portal and approved employer program as well. And we are going to launch some face-to-face and blended events and conferences. Okay. So as well as the differentiation and support is concerned, I am the in-country representative over here in Pakistan, and we are organizing some local CPD events, which are some online and physical as well. And we are giving the bi-monthly magazine and digital platform weekly e-newsletter to our membership, to our members. So as well as the CPD is concerned, this is a regulatory requirement of Institute of Financial Accounting UK for the members. And to fulfill this regulatory requirement, we are offering some online and physical CPD events on regular basis. So if anyone in today's session is who is having 3 years of relevant experience, or who is a member of ICAP, ICMA, or PIFA, ACCA, CIMA, or the CA finalist with some specific papers and ACCA finalist with some specific papers who has passed, they can join us as member. And there are some educational programs endorsed by Institute of Financial Accounting UK, and which are going to start in next couple of weeks. So one is the certified CFO program, and this is going to start from January 27. And then there is a diploma international financial reporting standard, which is going to start from the coming Saturday. And we have certified financial model, which is going to start from Monday. Okay. So now, without wasting the time, so I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Mr. Muhammad Hasnain Yusuf. And he is a joint director of State Bank of Pakistan. And I would like to request you, sir, to please start your session. Thank you very much. Sir, you can share your screen, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Shakur, sir. Okay. Are my slides visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So hello and good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, wherever you are. So this will be a short session, of course, the the subject is a very wide one. You can, you know, have a session for a weeks on this. But the way I've designed it, like I will discuss about some of the key trends that we expect going forward in the future about money, the finance, and by the virtue of that, these two accountancy, because accountancy is basically linked with these two in broader perspective. So I'm trying to have this as a 40 minutes of presentation and discussion followed by about 10 minutes of Q&A. But regardless, if you have any questions during the presentation or discussion, you can raise your hand or you can simply put it in the Q&A. I'll be happy to answer any questions in the meanwhile. So starting with the three things, the first thing we will discuss about three key themes in today's discussion. Firstly, we will discuss about the money, how the money has evolved and what do we see and what do we expect to for money to be in the future. It will be followed by a brief discussion on finance in a similar pattern, because finance in a way is linked with money and largely dependent upon our money. And then for the third session, we will try to see what are the trends going forward that will affect the accountants by the virtue of these two changes that we will discuss earlier. So starting with the future of money, before we look at the future of money, we will start with the history, how it started, because in most things, the future is nothing but a redesigned past. The same cycle goes over and over with different dynamics in each time. So it's not really a future, it's something drastically different, but it's kind of a reshaped form of the past, what has happened in the past, because you know there's always a logical evolution. So you can't really have an illogical future and a logical evolution of the past. So the future, the development of the future are dependent upon the cues from the past. They take cues from the past to us, so they go forward and so forth. So starting with the money, we all know that the money's initial form was the commodity money, which was basically because of the lack of standardization. So the acceptability was a key component. And then we started from like 500 BC, we moved from the commodity and unstandardized coins to more standardized money in the form of coins, in the form of metal things. And after that, there's a problem with the metal, because these money was basically dependent upon the supply of metals. And plus, there was non-standardization. There was it was very expensive. It was very weight. The weight of the metal was also one of the key factors. So the next evolution in the history of money was the invention of the paper money, initially in China and Europe, which happened around 800 AD, about 600 to 700 years after the invention of the standardized coins, starting from 118 AD to 800 AD, right? Then after that, we saw that initially paper money was packed with gold. Because initially before in between that proper, the initial money was formed in the private form of paper money, right? The private form of paper money was issued by earlier merchants. And then it was issued by a four formalized institutions that are the banks. But the problem with the private money was like the same thing that happened with the banks, like this money was more or less dependent upon the profile of the issuer of the money. So this was a major reason that we had a lot of bank failures happening around. So the paper money was shaped from a private paper money to the sovereign paper money. And then this sovereign paper money, because there were a lot of monies around, so to have that sort of a standardization that primarily led to the invention of the coins, we had that the paper money was packed with the gold in the Bretton Woods. But then again, it suffered from the same setback as the standardized coins, because the monies, the supply of gold was exogenous. So the flexibility of issuing money, sovereign money, with the central banks or the governments was largely taken away. So this led to de-breaking of the pact subsequently, and each money was the monetary systems then turned into the fiat systems subsequently, where each money was nothing but the promise to pay and largely dependent upon the credibility of the central bank issuing the money. But in late 2008, we had the digital revolution, and we had the first digital form of token. We don't call it the digital money, but we can call it the digital token. The first digital token, Bitcoin, was issued, which was largely decentralized, and it could be traded without any restrictions on the normal forms of money. So crypto coins, CBDCs, a digital form of money, has been the latest in the revolution of the money that we have around us, and probably going forward in the future, all sorts of money we expect the digitalization of money will only increase, and in the future we will have all sorts of digital assets, digital tokens, or even in the case of the normal central bank money, to be converted into the digital form. So what's the state of money today we have? So generally speaking, central bank issues two types of money. First money is the bank reserves. We call combined these two monies are called the monetary base, which is provided by the central bank to the system, which forms the core of any liquidity in the system that is subsequently used. So a part of it, the money is a bank reserves, and the second part of the money is cash, okay? So we can actually see that these are two different type of monies which are actually developed for different types of market. Like for bank reserve money is basically used for the interbank market, where the banks can lend this money to each other and use this for all sorts of liquidity purposes. And outside the banking system, there's another form of money that we see, that's the cash. The cash is generally used for the general purposes in the economy. Banks don't find the cash any useful because they can't use it like they can use the bank reserves. So we have two forms of money. One is what we can say is a wholesale type of money that can be used in wholesale market, like the interbank market. And then we have a retail type of money that is cash that can be used in the retail form by the economic agents outside the banking system. But these two monies are interchangeable and are exchangeable with one another by 1-to-1 ratio, means $1 of cash can be converted into $1 of bank reserves and vice versa. So that kind of maintains the balance between the two, that can kind of maintains the credibility of both of the two, because they can be exchanged in 1-to-1, which is the same kind of concept that we see in the Bitcoin, stable coin, where the peg with the fiat currency is essential to be at 1-to-1, because if the peg is broken, then simply the Bitcoin, either the digital Bitcoin, digital stable coins, can't be converted into 1-to-1 ratio with the fiat currency, and we see that this kind of starts the spiral, downward spiral of the debt spiral of the stable coin, as we saw recently with Luna and so forth. So however, coming back to the forms of money, in bank reserve, as we discussed, the bank reserve is a wholesale part of the money, right? And it can only be used in the interbank market. So therefore, banks need some substitute to be used in the general economy. And for that matter, they generate the M1 or the checkable deposits. These deposits are a sort of an alternative to the central bank cash, but they carry, because they are created by the banks and they're not typically the central bank money, but then again, they also observe the same principle that they can be exchanged in 1-to-1 ratio with the cash. As long as these bank deposits are exchangeable in 1-to-1 with the cash, 1-to-1 ratio with the cash, the banks are considered solvent, like a stable coin. If this peg is broken, then we say that the bank is under the run, or bank is no longer solvent. The digital tokens are a new innovation. They are outside, they're not classified as either type of the money, but they are kind of integrated to some extent with the also all the with the financial system, because at least one part of these digital token transaction is settled into the financial system. For example, if I'm buying Bitcoins from somebody, I will pay him or her in some fiat currency in the consideration of buying those digital tokens. So one leg of this transaction is usually settled in the financial system, the normal money, but these money largely due to their properties, these digital tokens are cannot considered the part of the normal hierarchy of money that we have today. So looking at the evolution of money, we see that the, just like we discussed before, that the is this an a revolution or is this an evolution that we see in the future of money? So we see, I've actually charted some of the history of the money and how it's gonna become, it's going into circles with each and every time different dynamics, but the same logic. So initially, the limitation of the commodity money led to the creation of the banks and the private money. But with no central banks or no alternative to it, the growth of the banking and dominance of the private money dominated the markets of trade, economy. But we know that with increased private money, there's an increased risk of failure, because this private money was owned by a private lender who might have different private lenders had the different different creditworthinesses. So there were lots, if there was a large scale bank failure in some part, the money issued by that bank became unusable, became worthless. So the money was like not stable. We had different types of money competing against each other in the same system. So this risks and this risks of these private money actually led to, or the dominance of the private money led to the creation of central banks and the standardized legal tender, the money that we use today. However, after that, in late 80s, 1980s, with the invent of the computer and the payment system, digitalized payment system, the money that we discussed earlier, that is the bank reserves, went to digital, whereas the cash remained in the paper form. So with the digitalized money, the commercial bank money, with the invent of computers and the IT, the money that was again the private or the bank money, they increasingly went digital as opposed to the currency, which remained in largely paper form. So now what we see right now is that increasingly digitalized, there's an increasing trend of digitalization in private money, with not only banks, but now we have fintechs, we have commercial companies, data companies, they're all increasingly digitalizing, inventing the use cases of digital money, and they are actually dominating the market for the digital money. And now we are back to the stage two, where the growth of the money was dominated by the private sector. We are again at the same situation, and for citing the same reason, different policymakers around the world are now calling for a digital form of currency. They say that since the private money is now increasingly digitalized, we need to have sovereign legal tender in digital form as well, which we are now calling the CBDC. So CBDC can be a retail CBDC that can replace cash, or CBDC can be a bank reserve, a wholesale CBDC, which would be used in interbank market. So now some of the characteristics of the monies that we use today are as follows. So in terms of CBDC is kind of a hybrid of all three systems. It's an architect that borrows attributes, and its design can borrow certain attributes and can be designed to target certain segment of the people. For example, the biggest advantage of cash, the why cash has been one of the most I'd say amazing invention in the human history, is because the cash has two things. It's ease of use. The cash can be used without any friction. It can be used without any, with the minimal financial education, financial literacy, and it allows you a complete autonomy while conducting the transaction. The other two forms of money, the bank money is not as is a more efficient in terms that it allows you to do large value transactions at a fraction of a cost as compared to cash, which has a handling cost, which has a risks. The bank money eliminates all them, but that comes at the cost of losing out the anonymity, because the bank money is always traceable to the transaction. In terms of digital tokens, are a mix of between the borrow the efficiency and transferability and return from the bank money, but they also borrow the anonymity of the cash. However, the risk with the digital assets is that they are not a legal tender. There's always a lack of consumer protection at the heart, because most of these assets are unregulated, and there's always a risk of losing out your money in this. But given the fact that these assets are actually more successful recently, is because they combine the attributes of the two money, the best attributes of the two money, and then repackage them as digital tokens. With respect to CBDC, so we have three alternatives already with us. The first is the cash, then we have the bank reserves, bank money, and then we have the digital token. So the design choice of CBDC is largely influenced by which kind of assets do you want to target? Which kind of market do you want to target? If you want to target the people who are using cash, then your CBDC should closely track the attributes of the cash. That is, anonymity should be very prime, and then there's the ease of use and safety. On the otherwise, if your CBDC wants a wholesale market, you want to launch a CBDC for the wholesale market, then you'd have to incorporate the attributes of the bank money into that, which are desirable for the wholesale market, like reducing time lag, increasing efficiency, and so forth. So CBDC, in essence, is somewhere in between all of them. So it depends upon where you want to achieve from CBDC, from your CBDC. If there are generally two types of objective. First is to make the payments efficient in the wholesale market, and secondly, which is mostly falls in the purview of the wholesale CBDC, or you can actually target either the domestic side, which is why where the retail CBDC is more relevant for the central bank or for the policymakers. So it really depends upon what kind of objectives do you have in mind that ultimately influence the design of CBDC that you have with yourself. So coming back to what will be the attributes of the money of the future? Firstly, of course, the money, every money, and the most of the monies in the future will be virtual. Of course, cash will not go out, but its use will be drastically reduced, as we are already seeing in Scandinavian countries, where the digital money is having a lion's share in the overall payment transactions as opposed to cash. So the increasing amount of money will convert, use of money will be in the digital form in the future. Secondly, it will be more efficient because you now have the DLT technologies and other technologies that will come in that will increase the efficiency and reduce the handling costs and inefficiency that is generally connected with the use of physical cash. So this the money of the future will be more efficient as opposed to the monies that we have right now. Third and more importantly, the money of the futures will be more programmable. But by programmability, I mean that the users will be able to define the purpose of the spending of the where the money can be spending. For example, if you want your money to go to the charity, the money could be programmed in such a way that it will only be used and spendable on the charitable purposes and not elsewhere. Just like for the government, if you have a running a transfer, a cash transfer payment program, then the government would be able to program the money in such a way that it will only be used for the desired purpose and will reduce the misuse. So it's both pros. There are both pros and cons involved with the programmable money. But this is a very promising area of the money of the future. Then there will be a fungible money, just like with increasing issuance of money, increasing amount of private money in the system, there will be a time where there will be different monies. That's like we now have about 1300 to 1400 cryptocurrencies, right? So different money in digital form, there will be a lot of other monies that will be floating in the system. So there will be two different, at the same time, you will have two monies that are tracking the same money, but they will be issued by different issuers. So you don't have that sort of the money dominance and money issuance dominance by some of the players will be challenged by, there will be a lot of players in the future that will be issuing the digital form of money, but these monies will be tradable at can be traded at the same value, can be traded at the varying value with each other. So we will have a lot of money. So we will a lot of types of the same money, a lot of issuers of the same money. So the money might be traded at a very different rate to each other with both being the similar, performing the similar function. And then the money will be tokenized. Means right now, if a money is issued in a very fixed denominations, the money in the future will be issuable in very customizable way, in very small denominations, which would be able to suit the preferences of the issuer. And then there will be a lot of money, as we witness right now, especially in China and elsewhere. A lot of the fintech, the phenomena attached with the fintech is that a lot of the fintechs are now being owned by the companies which are historically not been associated with the financial services. So banking sector or the financial sector will be increasingly dominated by the companies which will be of non-banking backgrounds, but will be able to offer these solutions in the shape of use cases for the customers. Then financially inclusive, the money in the future will be digital money, will be more financially inclusive, because, you know, for example, in Bahamas, one of the key consideration for issuing the Bahamas CBDC, was that the Bahamas is physically a collection of different islands. So physical transfer of cash from one place to another is often very challenging and very risky. So by issuing a digital currency, the authorities think they'll be able to achieve greater financial inclusion with the safety and transferability of value. And lastly, right now we have a lot of capital controls in place in the shape of physical money. The moving the money from one place to another is often challenging and largely depends upon the laws of the land between two countries. In future, however, when the monies will be digitalized, there will be possibilities for freely holding or trading the monies of different outside the country. Right now, you need to go and you need to purchase. There are limits, there are everything in place. But in future, you will simply have the wallets. And those wallets, if they are interoperable, you will be able to hold more than one money in your similar wallet. So this will be one of the key, these are some of the key trends that we expect for money in the future. So well, there's been a lot of debate about digital tokens and their use and the risks. Central banks generally don't prefer to promote the digital tokens. However, the digital tokens might be risky because of the shortcomings and lack of regulation and so forth. But the underlying technologies are very useful. And due to that, the central banks are actually using those technologies, using those blockchains for developing their own sovereign currencies on the similar lines as the digital tokens. So here are some of the CBDC, some of the platforms or the blockchains which are being used by different central banks for designing their CBDCs. And we can see that a significant part of the CBDCs of the central banks are using the same blockchains which are being used by the other digital tokens. So the underlying blockchain is being increasingly seen as an opportunity by the policymakers and to leverage upon, and they're actually leveraging these technologies to promote the digitalization and ease of transactions using those blockchains. So here are some of the examples that tells you the promise of the digital digitalization of the blockchains can bring to the system. Like Federal Reserve is right now testing a wholesale CBDC project CEDA, and they recently released its results about in December or in a month back, about a month or two back. So there, one of the key results were that generally for an FX transaction in the wholesale market, the settlement takes about 2 days. But when under projects, either they deployed the DLT structure, they could just settle it in under 15 seconds. So that's a very drastic improvement over the traditional settlement systems that we have right now. And plus, it also demonstrated the ability of atomic settlement, which means a simultaneous settlement. So if you have the ability of atomic settlement, that means a lot of settlement risk that comes in, and the buffers that you maintain to avoid those settlement risks can be actually taken out of the system. So the free money, the liquidity in the system kind of increases due to the fact that the liquidity that is stuck to avoid the settlement risk is no longer needed due to the DLT. Secondly is the RTGS, or a large value payment systems. So Fed's new large value payment system, FedNow, will be a cloud-based large value payment system. Generally, right now, the payment systems are considered very crucial and critical aspects of the central banking and the national payments. So generally, banks prefer to have the LVPS managed in-house with more control on the data and the storage. But cloud is a new phenomenon, relatively younger phenomena. And Fed is now actually taking one of the key systems, most crucial payment systems in the economy, to the cloud infrastructure. So that kind of shows you the direction of the future, that generally we will have what kind of developments are going to happen around in the financial industry. So while the digitalization affects reduces some of the risks, it also creates some of the new risks with the technology. Just like in current paper-based systems, we have one of the key risks is the dive of the currency. Some of the central banks are trying to address it by the polymer notes and so forth, but generally speaking, in the form of a digital money, this risk is largely addressed, because you don't need to have any paper-based dependence on the for the money issuance. So this risk is largely addressed in the form of digital money. Then there's a handling risk. Of course, we talked it before, like, if the money is digitalized, then the handling risk, the handling of risk of physical money is also largely addressed. Then intraceability is a risk that is linked with anonymity will also be addressed if you have a digital form of money. However, there will be new risks. Once some of the traditional risks will go out, there will be new risks that will come in. And for most of them is the cybersecurity, the data protection, and of course, with the increased digitalization, the complexity of the system will also increase. So these are the new risks that we expect to have to see in the future with respect to money. So with respect to the second, now we move to the second part, that is the future of finance. So just like the money, the future of the banking also evolved in a very similar fashion. And just like we had like 2008, we had the first digital token. In 2009, we had the first digital bank launched in the US. So it's been more largely synchronous. The evolution of banking has been happening around in tandem with the evolution of money. The way the evolution of the money evolved, the banking system evolved in parallel with the evolution of money. So some of the key trends that we are witnessing right now, we expect them to persist in future. Historically, the banks have been more brick and mortar structure.
Hello. Sure. Yes, Spencer. Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Sorry.
No worries.
Right now in the future, we see that the banks will move into a very hybrid structure. Right now, even in Hong Kong, the Standard Chartered Bank runs a dual structure. They're also holding a brick and mortar Standard Chartered Bank, and they've also launched a digital bank in the name of Mox. So banks see, some of the banks see that as an opportunity where the digitalization allows you to increase competitively target the sections of the society which are susceptible or unreachable by the conventional banking in brick and mortar structure. So we will increasingly see either complete digitalization, but also new forms of banking structure that will evolving as opposed to merely brick and mortar structures that we had in the past. And secondly, while historically banking has been seen as an industry in whole, but in future, banking services will be largely disaggregated. So for example, some of the wallets will offer you deposit taking. There will be some fintechs that will be increasingly offer the payment services, for example. The stable coins are largely used by the users as a means for payments. So the banking services which has historically been offered as an industry will be disaggregated into different services, with all services being offered by different type of non-bank players in the future. So far we have seen the banking services have been exclusive in the nature. For example, the payment services through checks and other means have largely been offered by the banks alone. And now in the future, these payment services will be disaggregated and they will be offered by the players that do not have the traditional banking background, especially we see in China, where the Alipay and other provider of services are increasingly coming from a non-financial background, have evolved into the financial giants just because of the ability and their penetration into the general market and their ability to disaggregate and offer the services on a standalone basis, in opposed to a in the form of a bank. Sorry. So these are some of the key trends that we expect to happen in the future. The balance of power will gradually shift from banks to tech-savvy entities such as innovative fintechs. Right now, especially in developing countries, the banking licensing, the forming a bank is much more difficult than forming a fintech. So fintechs are coming up with ideas like how they can actually bypass the banking, the regulations that the banks have to obey and still be able to offer the services. Like Chime in US, they have a fintech. They're a fintech. They don't have a banking license, but they offer their banking services in partnership of the other banks. And they still have like 8 million users. They're the biggest new bank in the US. Secondly, the focus will be on customer orientation, where the data will be key. This is perhaps the most dominant trend that we're seeing right now, where the data disaggregation, data analysis is being increasingly used as a critical factor to gauge the consumer's preferences and then designing the products that actually offer them a better alternative as opposed to the traditional banking services. For example, the My Bank in China. My Bank in China offers like they don't use the traditional banks banks credit evaluation system. They use the big data analytics and they use more than 300,000 variables and payment related data to gauge the credit worthiness of the customer as opposed to the traditional bank that uses a traditional credit evaluation on for their credit customers. And then there will be a growing desegregation of how people consume financial services. Just like I said, right now the banks are generally considered as a deposit taking institutions. In the future, what we're seeing right now is that it's an increasing amount of wallets being offered by the non-bank entities elsewhere. And for example, some of the retailers are now offering the cards, the credit cards, allowing customers to purchase items on credit. We have so deposit taking and lending, which have generally been considered as a key element of financial intermediation, are now being offered in a very disaggregated way with different players focusing exclusively on one element of the financial services as opposed to offering the whole services as a package. Then disaggregation of value chains with more share of third-party focused products, allowing better economies of scale and scope. Right now, the in-house bank, generally the banks have used the in-house model of offering all the services produced or in-house, but right now the trends are changing and now we have third-party producers, for example the cloud providers. So focusing on an exclusive part of the value chain allows these players to not only scale up their products operations but also achieve both economies of scale and scope, offering better value proposition to the users as opposed to if those users use those services in-house. So in the future, we will have this trend going forward. We will have a lot of the value chain of the current financial services being targeted by the third party and which would be beneficial for both the service providers as well as the third party providers. For designing a better consumer focused products as opposed to the products we have right now. And then increased use of customer data aggregation and analytics. This is already happening. The companies need to, the fintechs, why the fintechs have been more successful in certain way than the banks, because their ability to use the data aggregation and analytics has been a great advantage for them, and have allowed them to design products which are better than the traditional banking products, and therefore offering better consumer experiences. So this is one of one of the key elements that we expect to witness going forward. And then we discussed it before as well. We will have hybrid structures of service delivery, where a bank might run all brick and mortar, partially digitalized and a fully digitalized entities in the same structure to actually target different niche of customers according to their needs. So let's, with that, we come to the last session of our talk. That is how these things will affect the accountants going forward. Right now, this is the traditional accounting and audit cycle, which partly has been digitalized, but also partly has been is being digitalized. But still, what will happen in the future is that a lot of the paper systems will go out of fashion. Even right now, the Fed is actually also testing the e-invoicing, which will allow different players in the industry to share the invoice with each other electronically without the need of any physical-based, paper-based invoicing. So in that situation, one of the key elements of audit and account is that you need to have some paper-based evidence. So a lot in the future, we might see an increasing trend of paperless bank, paperless-based evidence. So you will, it will be challenging for the traditional auditors or accountants to keep a track of transaction if these transactions turn into paperless as opposed to paper-based systems right now. Then the operational decision-making will be handled by AIs. Right now, auditors or accountants will have to audit trails, but in future, they will not be, the problems will not be in the trails or in documentation. The problems will be in the AI's decision-making. So instead of auditing the papers and the trails, the auditors will have to edit the logical structures or even the programming of the AI to see and where the biases or where the inconsistencies would be. Thirdly, as we discussed before, there will be an increased portion of outsourcing in the data, in the value chain. So right now, if the service delivery or the value chains are largely in-house, then that will with the increased portion of those value chains being with the outsource providers, the workload of the accountants would also increase. So you will have to deal with a lot of service third-party service providers instead of just one service provider that is providing it all in-house. So the linkages and the robustness of all those service provider system, in addition to your client, will also be important for the auditors. And just as we discussed before, the data storage will be remote. And a lot of data right now, if it is stored in-house, then these services will shift to the third-party providers, which will also be a challenging for the auditors to get the records or the trail of the transactions. And lastly, there will be increased mandatory disclosure and requirements, which might come into force and would evolve, would necessitate adaptation by the auditors and accountants to stay relevant in the industry. So I took this survey out of IFA's website. So generally, it discussed about, they asked the accountant, how confident do you feel about the future of you as an accountant? But about a significant number, that's like 41 out of 120, they said that they are not confident at all. So there's always there's always uncertainty amongst the fraternity about the future of of accountants, especially in the rapid evolution of the technology. So let's discuss some of the advantages and risks that what we expect to see and how we can actually counter them as an accountant before closing this talk. So increased need for skill and capacity development as mechanical skills might become obsolete very soon. So the skills, if you can count, if you can keep a track of documents, might not be as relevant as in the future. So in future, the need for capacity development and skill development will intensify because the obsolescence of non-intellectual skill will be very fast as opposed to intellectual skills. The increased need of CPD with the focus on intellectual talents. So you will have to evolve very rapidly in the emerging to cope up with the emerging technology and adapt them in time. Increased pace of knowledge obsolescence as the technology accelerates. The knowledge will become very obsolete in the future. So necessitates for the professionals to keep them updated of the latest know-how in an increased manner. New roles like chief automation officer, chief intellectual officer, chief supplier relation officer will be introduced, whereas some of the traditional roles like chief accountant, HR, or chief of a human resource officer, or chief people officer will be gradually reduced. So these are some of the changes that we expect to happen, that we expect will happen in the industry. So now some of the suggestions that I can think of about how we can handle those risks is like, more room for career growth in young fields like AI and big data. Like if the accountants, if you think that while the mechanical skills might go out of business, the new skills like AI auditing or understanding the big data, they will be, knowing them will put you at a very competitive advantage as opposed to the other people who will not adapt. So I think that for accountant bodies, it's also paramount that they start to think and incorporate these emerging technologies into their curriculum as well, to have their students well prepared for the future trends of the industry. Those who are agile will quickly stand out if you have a good hold or a good command over the emerging fields. That means that due to the lack of talent pools about the emerging talents, the people who have good command on these emerging and young fields will quickly stand out, and they will have a better career path as opposed to the traditional people who will focus on the traditional skills and not on the young fields that are coming around. Understanding and knowing about developments in the related field will be a key ingredient to success. Organization would start rewarding diversification and personal development on career path. That's because as we see that the young fields will have scarcity of resources, so if the employees or if the professionals are able to focus on these fields, this would force the organization to start rewarding these people on better of basis. And lastly, and most importantly, the key outward focus will be a key to success, because with so much happening around you, the organizations which are traditionally inward looking will not be able to adapt. So it will be essential for the organizations or for the professionals to look outside the organization, in the industry, in the allied industries, and timely gauge the trends or the changes that are happening around. So the organization which will be successfully able to do this, adapt to those changes, will be able to more successfully survive in the future. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'm open to it.
Thank you very much, sir. And if there is any question by any participant, just you can ask, you can write in the chat window, or you can write in the question and answer session, or you can even open your mic, I believe, or you can raise your hand, please. Thank you, Amar sir. If there is any question by any participant, just do let us know, please. Thank you, Amjad Saab. Any query, any question by any participant, please, if you want to ask any question or query. Thank you. Okay, so Asan Saab, I believe there are very good feedback from the participants. So there is one question, I believe. Okay, so Karam Sayed is also saying that it was very informative. So thank you very much, Karam. And let me check that if there is any other question. So thank you, Robert. Thank you, Adnan Saab. So Adnan Saab, I believe there is no question by any participant. So the participants are just saying that it was very informative and really informative. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. So I believe it is 6 p.m. over here in Pakistan, and some different, we have participants from different time zone as well. Okay, so there is a question, focus on future only need or focus on currently happening around is also required. So Azhar, there is a question by Zahid Farooq sir that focus
on future. I get it, thank you. Thank you, Zahid sir. I think future is not disconnected from the past. What we know about the future is that what we deduct or we deduce from our present, right? So if you can only gauge about what's happening in the future, if you are vigilant in the present, right? So if you know right now that there is an AI that is coming and you do not adopt, because AI will come, it might take like them 5 years or 6 years or 7 years for the industry to adopt it. But before those 7 years, you still have time to think and adapt about it when it becomes a widespread. So if you will, you know, if you're focusing right now, by preparing for the future, you should start focus on today, right? If you will start discussing those ideas from today, that means that will take time, and then that will prepare you for the future. You can't actually, you know, prepare yourself for the future by focusing on the future exclusively, right? So you need to prepare for that today. So I think that is very relevant. That if you are able to gauge and decipher what's happening correctly right now, then you can decipher the future in a better way as compared to just focusing on the future.
Thank you, Snan. So any other query or question by any participant, please? Any question by any participant?
I just want to Shakusam, will I send you the slides or?
Yes, there are some participants who are asking for the slides. So it will be good if you can send me up. So we will be able to share with the participants as well.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. So I believe there is no question, sir. So we should wind it up now. So thank you very much, Stan Yusuf, sir, for your valuable time. And really, it was a very informative session. And thank you for the participants as well. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.